Growing up, we didn't have friends outside the church. We didn't have pets. We didn't have TV. We didn't have computer until much more recent times. We didn't have technology in general. I wasn't allowed to go to the cinemas. I grew up in a group known as the Exclusive Brethren, presently known as the Plymouth Brethren Christian Church, from birth until I was 22.
And no means to demean Dad, but he said, I'd rather see you dead and in a coffin, having a brethren burial, than leave the church and go out into the world. And I've sort of thought about that for years, like that's a really harsh thing to say, like you'd actually prefer your oldest kid to be dead in a coffin in the ground. But then in the context, in his context, he was effectively losing me, like he felt he was going to lose me anyway. I know a number of families who have been ripped apart.
You work with them, you live with them, you go to school with them, you go to church with them, and you socialise with them. You could live up the road from them, but your culture might as well be from the other side of the planet.
I grew up in the Exclusive Brethren Church, so was the first of seven kids. Had a very sheltered life in Whangarei. Being raised in quite a sort of secluded or protected environment, while it has its drawbacks, it really meant that I had quite an idyllic upbringing. Like it was just cruisy, it was just good. I didn't have to worry about stuff.
Sense of community, whilst in the community, is very strong. They're very tight-knit, but that was if you were actually fully inside the group.
Growing up in the Brethren is a very loving environment, it's very caring. Everything is there for you. There's a constant social circle, there's a network of friends and family, there are people who care about you. That's one of the hardest things about leaving a church like the Brethren, is that you go through that process, you know you're doing what's right, but also at the same time you know that you following what you believe is the right thing to do is going to cause unspeakable pain to a whole lot of people you care about. I mean, the thing that really sticks out is you don't realise fully until you leave that you have these gaping holes in your knowledge of how the world works. And it's the smallest things, like not knowing how to eat in a restaurant, like you don't know what the protocol is for ordering food or getting the waiter's attention because you've never eaten in a restaurant. Or not knowing how to use a TV remote, or things that you don't know that the news is on at 6 every night. There's a complete gap in terms of your knowledge of popular culture, because in terms of movies, TV shows, music and so on, you just haven't been exposed to it. Yeah, so your next door neighbours could be Brethren, if you were living in a city where there was a Brethren church. So they're not isolated in the way that other church groups like Gloria Vale are, where there's a completely separate commune. But I think with the Brethren, the barriers between them and other members of society are much more psychological. You know, they have this mindset that they're in the world, but not of the world.
Just some of the little rituals and rules and just what they would have considered normal, that we're just like, wow, that's so weird, that's so different. You're just asking 100 million questions, and new stuff comes up all the time, which is funny. Like, we've been together like nearly four years, and we'll get together with a group of others who have left the church as well, and then some little thing will come up and they're all cracking up laughing, and everyone in the room who's hadn't been in the church were like, we have no idea what's going on.
I remember neighbours doing things differently. It was the simple things. They sat in front of a telly and they watched their show. Didn't know what that meant. Hadn't heard of that term until hearing a neighbour say it one day. I talked into another neighbour about a show. Somebody hopping into their car and turning the radio on. That was foreign. We didn't have that growing up. And just watching people in social settings. Neighbours was definitely an opening point for me to realise that I was different, things were different. They didn't have large groups of people over to their homes, they had very little family to their home on a regular basis. They'd go out for a long time, never come home. That's when I thought, I wonder why, how we're different. Didn't really understand that, obviously. Started school, different again. You know, the children were different. Even the way they spoke was different. Their families, you know, seeing their parents was different, were different to mine. And that was obviously used to reinforce the fact that we were special because we were different. We used to have to wheel the TV into the class, and I was taken out of the class by the teacher, by order of my parents, that we weren't allowed to watch the movie that was going on there. We weren't allowed to play the game on the computer when we first got computers in the class when I was about six. That was new for everyone. Some of the kids had already obviously had it at home, didn't understand it, didn't get my head around it.
Ruben really struggles with bring a plate type attitude that Kiwis sort of have. You go around to someone's for dinner and say, oh, can you bring a salad or can you bring a dessert or whatever it is, because that's just not something that would have been done. You know, you go to someone's house and they absolutely put it on. Like, I remember him telling me the first one he went to when he came out of the church, someone said, I'll bring a plate, and he's like, what, do you not have enough crockery? Do you know, like, what do you mean I have to bring food to your house? Like, is that a thing? So, yeah, stuff like that.
It would be little tiny situations when you'd be like driving up and you just refuel the car, and you'd be sitting in there with the rest of your family and just watching the other families go by, and okay, they look like a normal family and they look like a normal family, and looks like he's come back from sport or something like this. Like, they don't look that evil actually, and yet we're busy saying in the church that, like, these people are on the highway to hell sort of thing. Like, they don't look like that, they look happy. People in the world aren't happy. Well, they look really happy. Look at that family over there, like they're having a good old chuckle.
Well, a while ago, it was like a Bambi reference. You know, like something about Bambi's father, you know, mother being shot or something, being the most traumatic thing of your childhood, and it's just like, nothing. You know, hasn't seen it. Or like even like, you know, Run Forest Run or any of that real classic stuff, it's just like,
growing up, the outside world was portrayed in an extremely terrifying manner, really. A place where if I was to leave, I would be doomed to fail, doomed to not succeed at life, not be happy, not achieve my goals in life. I would encounter unfriendly people who would use me for what I had to offer and then move on to the next person. They were all tools of the devil, and that's where they were going. They were going to go to hell, and if you left and you were there with them, that's where you would go. I had just over 3 hours' notice to vacate the house of myself and all my possessions. We lived on the corner of a roundabout in a quiet suburb. I remember driving around that roundabout. My eyes didn't leave the house. The prospect for me was more not seeing them again. Not seeing my mother again for a long time, not seeing my father. Knowing that I was now the rejected person. The very first thing I did was I drove away from the home and I parked up in a car park lot. I ended up being taken in by somebody who just met me.
I literally went home after Mum came to work, went home, waited till she came to work, went home, got all my clothes, my piano, everything I could stuff in my car, took it round to my flat, dumped it off into my flat, went back to work as if nothing had happened. Like, felt a little bit sort of underhand, but probably the nicest way to go actually, just not cause a scene, not cause a fuss, just wait till everybody's out of the situation, get my stuff, get it out, and then just not come back that night.
There was certainly one day where I knew that it was past the point of no return, and I knew that I was going to be excommunicated by the church, and so I was living in Invercargill, which is where I grew up. And so I spent a day driving around Invercargill saying goodbye to people like my grandma, my uncle, my auntie, my friends, and so on. And as I knew absolutely when I was saying goodbye to those people that that was probably the last time I'd ever see them. And so there's quite a finality about that.
It's not like you decided to move away for a few months and then you'll go and talk to mum and dad later on and connect with your brothers or your sisters and your family in a few months' time. For a lot of people, this is goodbye forever. I was in my mid-teens when I realised something was different, in a big way, that who I was didn't match the mould. When my sexuality came up as a topic of conversation with my priests, that one of them said to me, "Have you considered medication?" They believe that you've somehow chosen that path, that you have decided that you should become this and you're going to stick with it. I've been told to fight who I am as a person for the rest of my life because God made me that way and he made me that way to prove to him that if I could fight it, then I'm worthy of, you know, going into heaven, entering into heaven. I didn't walk away. The brethren walked away from me. And at that final stage, that was when I walked away from them full and complete.
I left the church. It was mostly because I was gay. And I could see that being gay in a group like the Exclusive Vision wasn't going to work in the long term. So I was sent to live in Sydney, which is where the world leader of the church lives. And while I was there, I was prescribed, I was sent to see a brethren doctor, Mark Craddock, and he prescribed me a hormonal suppressant, Ciprostat. And the basic effect of the drug is to cut off the supply of testosterone. And I think the thinking behind that was that if they couldn't immediately change my sexuality, they could at least remove my sexual feelings altogether.
I wasn't obliged to take it.
You recommended he took it though?
If he wanted to. We say his matter. He came to see me voluntarily.
Doctor, excuse me for saying this, but I don't know of any other medical practitioner that would recommend this.
I was aware of other people in the brethren who had tried to suppress their sexuality and ended up getting married and having a family, and inevitably at some point in their life they would have a breakdown and come out as gay. And I just thought I was heading for an inevitable collision with the church, and to me it made sense to get it over and done with.
They believe this, they genuinely believe this, that people that leave to some degree are possessed or have some possession of evil.
It was not that I didn't dislike anybody, it wasn't that I actively disagreed with the church, I just felt that I could do better outside the church. I was too much of a free thinker to actually go along with some of their concepts, and that's all it was. And my sister, who was used to be really good mates with my second sister, comes in and she gave me a big hug and she was just in tears, like she was just beside herself, and she said, just said to me, "The devil's got you, the devil's just got you." And I said, "No, like I'm the same guy. I still love you, I still love what I'm doing, I just don't quite believe in the trajectory of the church. I don't really think it's the right place." And again, like that really tugged at the heartstrings. It was so hard to see her so upset.
Some people keep in touch regularly, others don't. Some people will never see their parents again. Some people will never see their siblings again, or hear from them, or know they got married, or know they had a child. I wasn't even told about one of my family members passing until months later. The funeral had long since happened. I had always asked to have been informed, but it wasn't.
But I remember, you know, running into my grandma at the bank and she wouldn't talk to me. So in a way, it's as though some of these people are still alive, but it's as though they've already died. And I mean, my grandma actually died last year, and I went down to Invercargill and saw her at the hospice the week before she died. But sort of, I was in that strange position of, it felt to me like she'd already died 8 years ago.
The person isn't dead, they're still there. They didn't go in the coffin, they didn't go in the ground, but you can't really contact them anymore.
The first thing I realised when I left home was, I had no reference points. I spoke to my father, who said that he would make some inquiries as to whether people I'd previously worked for would do a reference for me. The first response I got back was a no.
The exclusive brethren have a way of life that potentially you could argue impacts someone for the either remainder of their life, or it can set them up perhaps in a negative sense if they choose to leave that perspective. It's a real challenge because there's some sort of beautiful simplicities with living life like the brethren, but then the flip side is then that you're not ready for the real world.
Me and another girl who's within, we're good friends with another couple who's, he's ex-brethren as well, and like it's really good me connecting with her because we sort of deal with similar stuff within the relationship, and you know, similar thought patterns and behaviours might come up, and it's really good to have her to bounce off and go, oh my gosh, he's just done this, and she's like, oh, I've totally had that. Or, oh, that'll be, you know, I remember they were talking about this sort of thing happened, and you're like, oh, okay. It's almost like the partners of the ex-brethren need to build their own support network too.
People should be free to practice whatever religion they choose, so long as that doesn't affect the personal rights and freedoms of other people. And I think that human rights and freedoms should always trump religious freedoms.
I've also found the world to be much more interesting, much more entertaining, and much more friendly than I ever thought possible. The caring nature of the average person is much more than I would have ever thought. Life's beautiful, and life's there for you to take advantage of it. This is your chance at life, not your chance at life to be told how life should be done, when in fact that's not the way it should be done.
I'm not here converting people to leave, but I'm here if you want to ask questions.
Does the pain ever really go away? And the conclusion was that we didn't think it ever would. It just becomes something that you manage and something that you deal with.
One of the saddest things is that his parents don't get to see what an amazing job they did at raising him, and that transition from a young man into a father, and just what a fantastic job he's done of that. Like, I get comments all the time from my friends just watching him with little Mason and with my boys is just amazing. He's just absolutely a natural. I think they'd be super proud of him. And not even just that, like just what he's done with his career and his life. I think they'd be really proud of him, and I'm really proud of him, and it would be awesome to share that with someone else who loves him as much or more than I do.
I count myself happy now. I am not having that pressure to conform to something that I'm not, and actually being who Vaughan really is the happiest thing that I could do.